Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Dwarf, The Mine, and the RPG Apocalypse. Dwarf Smith from Earth, by Constantin Stepp. Narrated by Daniel Thomas May. Chapter 1. Prologue. Even at 3 p.m., no light could reach inside this abandoned mine in Colorado. If not for the light from his flashlight, Derek Smith wouldn't see anything at all. Thankfully, he had come prepared. This 18-year-old 12th grader could be mistaken for a child from afar and for a middle-aged man from close up. While being only 4'8", 142 centimeters in height, his bulging muscles made him almost as wide as he was tall.
"I can't believe that I'm doing something this reckless,"
the boy cursed himself as he stroked his large black beard. A week ago, Derek, together with a couple of his friends, explored this abandoned mine just for fun. As far as the boys knew, it should have been reasonably safe, as long as they didn't venture too deep, that is. Back then, a genius idea visited Derek, taking his handmade Thor's hammer replica, Mjolnir, he just added the second O to avoid any copyright infringements, to test it on some rocks. Yeah, not the smartest thing to do, no matter how safe this mine was supposed to be. But as the saying goes, boys will be boys. It was all fun and games until Derek's best friend, Andy Larson, accidentally dropped the precious hammer into a dark pit inside the mine. Maybe the weapon was a replica, but it was probably heavier and more dangerous than the original used in movies. Out of everyone Derek knew, only his foster father could handle Mjolnir as easily as he.
"I guess it fell somewhere here."
Derek looked around, trying to remember the exact place. The mine was fairly big, with many very similar passages. After walking around for about 10 minutes, relying only on his memories and intuition, Derek arrived at the place where he had camped with his friends before. As he pointed his flashlight, he could recognize the traces of their fun. Some crushed rocks, some drawings on the walls, some cracked coconuts.
"Okay, here is the pit where Andy dropped my treasure,"
the boy thought to himself as he approached the dark hole. When they were here the last time, none of them had brought a rope. A grave error, now that he thought about it. What if Andy had fallen together with the hammer? Maybe choosing this place as their exploration target was a mistake in the first place. Then again, the high school graduation ceremony was only a couple of weeks away. After that, there wouldn't be many chances to get together and go on an adventure. Derek and the others wanted to create some memories that would last for the rest of their lives, and they more than achieved this objective, though he really disliked the price he alone had paid for that.
"Just wait for me, my little treasure,"
Derek thought as he tied his sturdy 30-meter-long rope around a large, unmovable boulder nearby. From what he could see with the flashlight, the pit wasn't very deep, only 6 meters or so. It seemed that it led to a whole other level of the mine. The fact that he couldn't see Mjolnir at the bottom worried him a little, but he hadn't borrowed his foster father's Ford Focus and driven it here for 2 hours just to chicken out at the last moment.
"Here I go, then."
Derek braced himself as he tightly grasped the rope and cautiously descended down the hole with surprising nimbleness in spite of his almost square figure. Suddenly, when Derek was still halfway to the bottom, the whole mine started to shake. At this moment, an ethereal but energetic and feminine voice echoed in his head.
"Hello, sentient inhabitants of Earth. My name is EN26433832798 AI Gamma, but you can call me Enigma. Wink."
As the voice reverberated through his head, Derek also could see holographic blue words that repeated the content of this strange speech.
"Hee-hee, now that I think about it, 8 billion of you are listening to me at this exact moment. It's so embarrassing. Blush."
The mine didn't stop shaking, but the boy still tried to finish his descent quickly. At the same time, he also noticed a subtle feeling of barely perceivable energy flowing through his whole body.
"Anyway, your planet at last awakened. It started to combine with the energy known to your scientists as dark matter. My sisters and I just call it ether, though. When combined with solid matter, the result is usually a big boom. And then the planet is reborn at a higher level of existence, free of all the annoying little pests, you guys included. A beaming smile.
With a shock, Derek realized that he wasn't getting closer to the solid ground. Instead, it seemed that the mine was expanding.
But fear not, for I'm here to help. Wink. Using my super-duper power, I can slow down the process, allowing the life forms to adapt to the sudden change. There are a couple of minor problems, though. A sad sigh.
As he looked down, Derek realized that 30 meters separated him from the hole's bottom. With only about 5 meters of rope left, he instantly understood that descending further would be meaningless.
To help Earth digest ether properly, I need to first connect it with our network of awakened planets. There is no way around it, so you are going to have new neighbors. Congratulations! Joy!
Just as Derek thought of climbing back to the top, his flashlight illuminated something metallic. Far below, in the corner of the big hollow area where the hole led, his treasured hammer lay. Seeing it made him hesitate.
Excess ether alongside the planetary level integration will result in a massive change to the landscape, be it natural or artificial, of your planet. Animals will evolve and monsters hidden until now will appear. You can bid goodbye to your current civilization. Sorry. Waves a hand.
Don't be ridiculous, Derek. He told himself, there's no way you'll survive if you jump from this height.
I would love to chat with you more, sweeties, but there is just way too much work waiting for me.
Making the only rational choice, the boy decided to climb. It sure helped that the mine didn't tremble so much anymore.
Enjoy the system I've created to help your adaptation to this brave new world, my little cuties. Wink. Please survive and get stronger. Bye-bye. Waves a hand.
Just as Derek started to ascend, a low, bestial roar resounded somewhere above him.
What the?
Before he could make sense of the current situation, the boy felt the rope become extremely easy to pull. Nothing surprising about it, as soon after that, gravity made him know the whole seriousness of his predicament.
Ah!
Derek screamed in his deep-toned voice as he accelerated towards the ground. The unexpectedness of the situation made him drop the flashlight, losing his sole source of light as it either turned off or broke in the process. Unlike what people say, he didn't see his whole life flashing before his eyes as he approached the floor. Maybe it was still too soon for that? With a loud thud, the boy landed on his sturdy, short legs as he bent his knees and tried to fall to the side while not forgetting to protect his head with his hands. He had heard that this whole course of action helped people to survive a long fall. Though he didn't put much faith in his actions, it seemed that he somehow survived. His body, especially his legs and his right shoulder on which he landed, screamed in pain. But he didn't die. Against the odds, he survived. As Derek Smith lay on hard stones, he sighed with relief. Then, thanks to the complete darkness, he realized that the holographic subtitles, which transcribed everything the ethereal voice said, didn't completely disappear. Instead, they hid in the upper right corner of his sight. As soon as he focused on them, the words expanded. The boy noticed that they added more messages this time, though.
You have taken 96 fall damage. Warning. You have less than 10% of HP left. Your body is no longer protected by ether, so it'll take the full damage from all sources. Congratulations, you have earned a title. Even gravity can't stop me. Uncommon.
Intuitively, the boy wanted to know what the meaning of this was, and a new text appeared.
You have fallen down on solid matter from a significant height and survived to tell the tale. Effect, you receive 50% less fall damage, as long as the height you fall from doesn't exceed 50 meters plus 3 meters per your level.
Holy cow!
Derek couldn't help but curse as he read.
Have I inhaled some hallucination-inducing gases while in this hateful mine? because everything I experienced in the last few minutes is fucking crazy.
He had heard that cavers and miners could start seeing hallucinations after spending days with their senses partially depraved, but he had arrived here just half an hour ago. Or maybe his sense of time became distorted as well. The holographic words that reminded him of an RPG game disappeared as soon as Derek willed them to. Then he also noticed that at the bottom left corner of his sight, three horizontal bars existed. One red, one green, one blue. Before he got a chance to examine the bars, a distant growling caught his attention. He immediately regretted raising his voice before and remembered the bestial roar from above.
Shit! It seems that I've celebrated my survival too soon. If everything I encountered isn't just my delusion, then the whole world is in turmoil right now. I hope my friends and family are all right. But first, I need to find a way to recover and get the hell out of this cursed place.
The boy took his smartphone out of his trousers. Relying just on his sense of touch, he tried to turn the phone on, but it didn't work for whatever reason. Strange.
Well, just perfect.
In the total blackness, Derek Smith could only wait until he recovered. He hoped that it would be before the growls came close enough for their owners to notice him. But, for now, there was the system to explore. It would be the best tool to help him survive. At least, if everything the being named Enigma said was true. Chapter 2. Lying on the cold, solid ground inside, complete darkness made Derek uncomfortable. His damaged body didn't improve his mood either. Still, a part of him hid undeniable excitement about the current situation. A part of him felt truly alive like never before. Derek concentrated his attention on the bottom left corner of his sight where three horizontal bars could be detected. The green bar was completely dim, except for the small leftmost section, while the red and the blue stayed bright.
I wonder if I can make those bars and text disappear, he thought. It would be annoying if they stay in my sight all the time.
As if following his command, both displays disappeared as if he turned off a heads-up display in a video game.
Wow, I guess they react to my intentions. How the hell does it work? Is it somehow connected to my brain?
Trying not to think too much about it, he made the colored bars reappear and then focused his mind on them. Instantly, a very simple screen entered his sight.
HP, 4 of 100. AP, 20 of 20. MP, 10 of 10.
Well, it doesn't tell me much, other than the fact that I've almost died. I want to know more.
His wish came true immediately, and what he learned as a result shocked Derek Smith deeply.
Status. Name, Derek Smith. Level, 1, 0%. Primary class, none. Subclasses, none. Race, Royal Dwarf. Dormant, level 3, 47%. Professions, Mastersmith, rare. Level 9, 56%. Student, common. Level 4, 30%. HP, health points, 4 of 100. Regeneration rate, 20 per hour. AP, aura points, 20 of 20. Regeneration rate, 40 per hour. MP, mana points, 10 of 10. Regeneration rate, 3 per hour. Attributes.
Wait, what?
Derek couldn't help but exclaim even before he could read everything to the end. Even the ever-closing growls couldn't stop the boy from raising his voice. Derek Smith always knew that he was different from other people. He had never met his real parents and spent the first 7 years of his life at an orphanage. He and those close to him often joked about him being a dwarf, and Derek definitely felt close to this fantastic race. But he always thought that short people like him and those with a medical condition known as achondroplasia, which doctors confirmed he didn't have, were the real-life sources of the legends. Throughout the history of humanity, discrimination was common, so it wouldn't be strange if humans who looked different were treated as some non-human beings. Up until now, he spent his life always being certain that he is a human, like his friends and family, just a little special. But according to this status thingy, his actual race was Royal Dwarf.
This can't be true. It just can't.
Derek repeated as he stroked his black beard to calm himself down. The boy had always believed that it didn't matter who his real parents were. His foster family treated him kindly, loved him, and he had never felt the need to find those related to him by blood. Until now. Why would a dwarf child live among humans without knowing anything of his origin? Why had his real parents separated him from the rest of his kin? Derek Smith didn't know, but now he wanted to find the answers.
For a start, I would like to learn more about my race,
he mentally said, and the system didn't disappoint his expectations.
Royal Dwarf, dormant, level 3, 47%. The dwarf race is a humanoid race preferring to live underground and mostly found on already awakened planets of gamma and beta grades. Dwarfs are generally known for their sturdy bodies, outstanding craftsmanship, powerful earth magic, and relatively short statures. Biologically divided on those of common, noble, and royal blood, dwarves live in a strictly hierarchical society. As a royal dwarf, even if unawakened due to your lifelong separation from ether, you have exceptional potential for growth and multiple special boons. Yay! Very happy. Racial talents, dwarf senses, mineral consumption, stone body.
I expected something more informative,
Derek thought as he read.
I still don't have the slightest clue as to where I should look for my kind. What the hell does gamma and beta planets mean? Well, whatever. I have more important matters to worry about. For example, escaping this mine and finding the people who really care about me, unlike the supposed family I've never even met.
Still, he needed to know what those three talents did. He had a hunch that they would be really useful to help him survive.
Dwarf senses. Active. Dwarves are well adapted to live in underground cities, caves, and mines. Very useful ability if you like dark places. Due to you being still unawakened, the talent requires manual activation and mana to use. Very unhappy. Effect. This talent allows you to see even in complete darkness. 150 meters times race level. To sense rare ores in your vicinity. 0.5 meters times race level. And to perceive vibrations through solid matter. 100 meters times race level. Duration. 10 minutes plus 5 minutes per race level. Cost. 5 MP.
Hell yeah!
The young dwarf cheered inside.
With this ability, the lost flashlight wouldn't be a problem. I just need to know how to activate it. I'll figure that out later.
Mineral consumption. Passive. Deep underground where dwarfs live, normal food is often scarce. But it isn't a problem when you can literally eat rocks. Surprise! This talent allows you to consume and digest minerals, but not pure metals. You can also store them inside your body for further use. Not the healthiest diet for the long term, but it could sustain you for a couple of months. Awakened dwarves can survive on stones alone. Let this fact be your inspiration. Joy. Maximum storing capacity, 5 kilograms plus 1 kilogram per race level. Currently stored minerals, 0 of 8 kilograms.
Are you serious? Hey, is this real?
Derek didn't get the answer from his system no matter how he willed. Maybe it couldn't read his mind that well after all. The existence of this skill reminded the boy of a couple of events. When he was just a little kid, a few times he had eaten actual stones and found them tasty, only to be scolded by his mom later. And now he had learned that this could have been not just a childish curiosity at work, but his instincts as a dwarf.
Stone body, passive plus active. Dwarves are famous for being tough, like really tough. This talent is the reason. Passively, it makes your bones and muscles relatively hard to damage. But there is more. You can activate this talent to deplete minerals stored in your body and, as a result, make your skin hard as stone. The better the minerals, the better the effect. Pro tip, try using diamonds. Twinkle wink. Passive effect. Bonus 5 constitution. Additionally, 1 constitution per race level. active effect. Minerals are absorbed to create a defensive barrier and increase the durability of the body. How high armor of the created barrier is depends on the composition of the minerals and your race level. Mineral hardness plus 10% times race level. Cost, 5 AP or 10% of total AP, whichever is higher, per 1 kilogram of consumed minerals. Duration, 10 seconds per 1 kilogram of consumed minerals. Cooldown, 180 minutes minus 15 minutes per race level, 180 minus 15 times race level. Currently, 135 minutes.
Derek didn't doubt the passive effect of this talent. Since his younger days, the boy showcased extraordinary sturdiness of his body. One time, while still being inexperienced in smithing, he hit his finger with a hammer. It freaked out his father, but for naught. Let's say that the one to get broken wasn't the finger.
Now that I think about it, throughout my whole life, many things hinted at my true origin. But how could I just believe in something so crazy without any real evidence? Soon, though, I'm going to confirm this reality firsthand.
Derek checked his health bar.
HP, 8 of 100.
He vaguely felt how a sort of soothing energy overlapped his body, slowly improving his condition. The boy tried to stand up, only to find himself losing his balance and hitting his head on something solid, eventually ending up on all fours. A new notification appeared.
You have taken 1 physical damage.
It barely hurt, but he decided that, before trying to move again, he should test his dwarf talents. So he stayed in his awkward position with his toes, knees, and hands to the floor and tried to activate his newfound ability. If it works, it would be undeniable proof of his origin. The system answered his intentions.
Dwarf senses activated. You have lost 5 MP. The calculated duration time is 25 minutes.
Derek could feel how something inside of him channeled to his head, adding clarity to his mind. And, as if his senses awakened, he started to see the world around him as if someone turned the lights on.
It worked! It fucking worked! I'm really a dwarf!
The boy thought with amazement. What happened proved that everything he experienced so far was real, that the system worked, that it told him the truth. As he looked around absent-mindedly, Derek found himself at the center of a large cavern. The place didn't look like an artificial mine anymore. Gray stalactites with pointed tips hung from the ceiling. The brown stalagmites with rounded tips grew from the floor. Even with his newfound sight, the boy couldn't see the top of the hole through which he descended. As he was still on all fours, he noticed something out of normal. He could sense distant vibrations through the ground with his hands, and this feeling seemed to be rather accurate. He could determine the location of 4 entities that unhurriedly got closer to his cave chamber from different directions.
Shit, he cursed inside. One of them is less than 100 meters away from the cavern's entrance.
He didn't know what exactly this creature was, but he doubted that it would be very friendly.
I guess my best bet is to use my new senses to hide from whatever this thing is.
Just as he formed this simple plan, a certain item caught his attention. Derek Smith wanted to exclaim but held himself back at the last moment.
My treasure!
He thought with glee. At last, what he came here for was almost within his reach. Chapter 3 Derek Smith stood up from his awkward position and, ignoring the lingering pain in his legs, slowly moved to one of the cavern's corners. He didn't separate his sight from his dear hammer that waited for its creator to take it and return home.
Come here, my little treasure,
Derek quietly muttered with a grin as he reached his hands toward the replica. Just as he touched Mjolnir's stout handle wrapped in brown leather, a sudden notification appeared.
Mjolnir, level 7, soulbound, rare, a hammer forged by a mastersmith. The strong emotions and dwarven nature of its creator secretly resonated with ether and gifted the weapon some peculiar characteristics. Requirements: level 5, 15 strength, 4 free equipment slots. Derek Smith can ignore all of those, including the free equipment slots requirement. Damage: 14 to 17. Physical, blunt. Mass, 33 kilograms. Durability, 28 of 29. Traits. The creator, Derek Smith, can always ignore this weapon's requirements, and he can track it if lost. When equipped, the hammer increases the effectiveness of all forging when used by Derek Smith. Mjolnir can evolve together with its creator.
Holy cow, this is amazing!
Derek felt genuinely happy. Not because of the stats of the weapon, but because even the system acknowledged his sentiments toward his masterpiece. The efforts he spent on forging this hammer were rewarded in the most unexpected way. As he picked up this heavy, square-headed short hammer, another notification appeared.
Do you want to equip Mjolnir?
Derek tilted his head, because he already held the weapon just all right even before responding to the holographic message. Maybe equipping it officially would change something?
Yes, I want to equip it,
he mentally answered. Immediately, hot energy flowed through his fingers towards the hammer in his hands. A peculiar connection formed between him and Mjolnir, but if asked, Derek wouldn't know how to explain this feeling in words. He slightly swung the weapon and immediately noticed the difference from before equipping it.
Grrrr.
A low and not-so-distant growl echoed through the cave. Mesmerized by multiple new findings, he almost forgot that unknown creatures got closer and closer to him with each passing minute. Derek bent his body down and touched the ground with his free hand.
Shit, the closest one is 30 meters away from the entrance towards here, the dwarf noted. The other three are at least 60 meters away.
From what he could see, this cave chamber didn't have any other tunnels connected to it than those four occupied by growling creatures. It meant that if Derek wanted to escape, he needed to cross paths with at least one of those beings.
There are enough stalagmites and boulders for me to hide, so maybe I could just distract the thing and enter the tunnel without any confrontation. The question is, where could I get any bait?
In the first place, Derek didn't know much about his opponents. What would distract them? As he surveyed his surroundings, the dwarf noticed an elongated black object lying under a boulder.
Maglite flashlights are famous for their high quality, so it shouldn't be broken, right?
Derek approached the item, hoping for the best. Fortunately, after tinkering with the flashlight for 10 seconds, he made it work.
Okay, then. Let's hope that whatever this thing is, it'll be curious about a source of bright light.
Derek thought of a simple plan. He'll leave the maglite far away from the tunnel through which the creature comes. The boy himself will hide behind stalagmites. Then he'll slip away behind his opponent's back while it inspects the bait. This course of action should allow him to avoid any risks whatsoever.
It can work,
Derek thought as he left behind the flashlight and concealed himself. Before he could use his vibration senses, as he named them, Derek heard something slithering through the cavern.
Grrrr.
A growl resonated through the cave chamber. Its source was only 20 meters away from Derek, but he couldn't see the creature because a large stalagmite separated them. The boy could hear his foe slowly advancing towards the sole source of light in this dark place. Apparently, the plan was working. Derek started to carefully sneak around boulders and stalagmites towards the now unobstructed tunnel entrance.
Should I try to eat some rocks beforehand, just in case?
Derek hadn't forgot about his two other, for now unused, talents. As he slowly advanced ahead, the dwarf took some stones from the ground and placed them in his mouth. He wasn't sure about their actual composition, but he assumed they weren't very hard, maybe 3 to 4 on the Mohs scale.
It tastes like shit.
As he swallowed them whole, a disturbing thought visited him, and the scariest part was the fact that it could be not just a metaphor.
You have consumed some minerals. Do you want to digest them for nutrients or to store them for future use?
To store,
Derek answered as he tried to hold back his vomiting reflex.
I guess even stones should be cleaned before you can eat them safely.
He made a note to himself.
Currently stored minerals, 0.1 of 8 kilograms.
Ugh.
He couldn't help but feel sick, knowing that he'd need to experience this taste again. After Derek placed another stone in his mouth, he noted with surprise that it didn't taste as bad.
Maybe I was just unlucky on my first attempt?
He placed another bunch of rocks and almost spat them all out a second later. It took him another 3 attempts to learn how to choose the better-tasting stones.
You live and learn, I suppose,
the dwarf concluded as he checked his talent menu.
Currently stored minerals. 1 of 8 kilograms.
I don't have the time to consume more,
Derek told himself.
It seems that the creature has already reached the flashlight.
The dwarf prepared himself mentally to leave his cover and sneak into the tunnel. With only 5 meters between him and the entrance, he hoped that he wouldn't be noticed. He had placed the flashlight about 30 meters away from the tunnel. So Derek did have some confidence to run away even if his plan failed. It seemed that whatever this thing was, movement speed wasn't its forte. As the dwarf peeked from behind a stalagmite in the flashlight's direction, he couldn't help but freeze.
What the fuck is this monster?
Derek expected to see a giant snake. He wouldn't be that surprised if something like Lamia from fantasy stories waited for him. But what he saw made him doubt his enhanced dark vision. Derek silently observed the being unlike anything he had ever seen. Its slim, black, 2-meter-long body squirmed toward the bait as a snake, but the upper half of its body stood vertically as a human would. Some gray, smoke-like substance leaked from its black, liquid-like exterior and completely surrounded the lower end of its tail. From his angle, Derek couldn't see the head at the top of the monster's sturdy neck, but he could see the other 2 heads at the end of its arms. 1/2 meter above its central head floated a holographic number of bronze color and a green health bar.
9?
He looked at the symbol.
Level 9? I doubt I can fight it with my level 1.
Just as the dwarf regained his composure, the flashlight twinkled a couple of times and then went out completely.
Why?
Derek thought, agitated.
The flashlight had enough energy to work for many more hours.
This situation reminded him of his cell phone, which had stopped working prematurely as well. The monster turned both of the hand heads toward the still-peeking dwarf, scrutinizing him with its creepy eyes that shined with blue light.
Grrr.
The 2 heads growled as the thing bounced in a strange slithering motion towards Derek. Knowing that the monster noticed him, the dwarf rushed to the tunnel without even looking back. Even though equipping his heavy hammer made it easier for him, its 33 kilograms of weight still slowed the dwarf down. With his short limbs, he couldn't move much faster than an average human, even if he was really athletic by human standards. Add to that his still hurt legs, and it wouldn't be surprising if even a 12-year-old could outrun him. As he sprinted, Derek could hear the monster chasing him, slithering at an even pace. The distance between the 2 decreased slowly but surely. It was only a matter of time before the dwarf would be forced to meet his foe head on.
I can probably outrun it if I drop Mjolnir,
Derek thought. Considering the current difference in speed, he needed to be only a little bit faster.
No, I can't do it,
the Mastersmith in him resisted.
This is my greatest creation. Even the Heartless System acknowledged our bond. Dropping Mjolnir would be no different than abandoning a comrade. Moreover, this is my only weapon. How could I protect myself without it?
Grrr.
The monster behind Derek roared with all 3 of its heads. It seemed to be annoyed by the fact that it still hadn't caught its prey yet, so its pace increased. Just as the dwarf contemplated if he should turn back and fight, a new notification appeared in the corner of his sight.
You have regained 10% of your HP. Your body is supported by ether again.
As he read the message, Derek could feel as if his body solidified, as if something supported it from the inside. The pain in his legs all but disappeared. He regained his peak condition.
I don't really understand what is going on, but the timing is perfect,
Derek rejoiced as he put more force in his legs.
Gee!
The creature didn't like this change. The dwarf ran at his full capacity and the monster no longer got closer. But how could racing at full speed with 33 kilograms in your hands be easy? Even with his much higher than that of a normal human endurance, Derek started to feel exhaustion after 5 minutes or so. and his pursuer, while being a little slower, seemingly showed limitless stamina. Despair started to crawl into his heart as Derek navigated complicated paths of the dark tunnels. Chapter 4.
What should I do? Derek pondered. Should I try to fight back before my stamina is completely drained?
Dropping his favorite hammer could probably save him this time, but it would doom him in a long-term perspective. With just his bare hands, how could he survive or get stronger? If not for his low HP, Derek would have probably first tried to fight before running away, even if the opponent looked dreadful and its level superior. The dwarf didn't know, after all, how strong his current self was. As things were now, he didn't want to risk the direct confrontation, unless as a last resort. As his breaths got rougher and rougher, Derek pushed his body to the limit. He realized that if he stopped now, he wouldn't be able to move at all, let alone engage the terrible creature in battle. How long was it? To Derek, the chase seemed to last forever. Without stopping, he pushed himself to the limit over and over again. He slowed down after each fork in the tunnel he encountered. He entered side paths, hoping that the creature would lose his tracks. Of course, those struggles were fruitless. His lungs started to physically hurt from how fast and desperately he breathed. His legs started to feel weak, and the dwarf noticed that the monster got closer and closer, that it kept chasing even when it couldn't see him. He started to feel that the creature just played around with its prey and, in fact, could catch him whenever it wanted. Occasionally, it roared, presumably trying to intimidate Derek or, maybe, other creatures. This probably was the reason why he didn't encounter any other monster even after running for so long.
Shit. I don't want to die just like this. I just found out that my whole life was a lie, that I'm not even human, and this would be my end? Bullshit! Hey, system! Can't you help me?
Of course, the system didn't give him an answer, but a peculiar idea entered his mind.
I didn't pay this much attention, but while I descended the hole with the rope, I vaguely felt different powers inside of me. One of them was solid, giving me the same feeling as when I regained my HP to above 10%. It should be health. The second one was like a chilly breeze, the same that I felt as I used my dwarf senses. It should be mana. And the third power that coursed through my whole body, just like blood.
As his limbs started to get heavy, Derek tried to catch the feeling of that flowing energy inside himself. He didn't know if it would change anything, but he hoped that it would. Based on how his stone body talent required AP to use, Derek assumed that this resource would be related to physical abilities. Maybe it could regenerate his stamina the same way health supported his body? The dwarf could hear as the monstrosity wailed in bone-chilling fashion just 10 meters behind him. Derek concentrated his full willpower on moving his tired body and trying to feel the liquid-like power that was supposed to exist inside of him. At last, he noticed a weak flow of something circulating through his body. Illusory, but real. Weak, but vibrant. He felt it. It was there. His aura. Then he ordered it to help his body to move, to run, to survive. With everything he had, he guided it to his limbs.
Congratulations, you have learned a skill. Augmented sprint. Bronze. Common.
A notification appeared, but he mentally wished for it not to distract him with long texts. And this seemed to work, as it stopped showing him what the skill did. Instead, immediately, adding another text.
Congratulations, you have earned a title. Aura Prodigy. Rare.
It seemed that he turned the long descriptions off as the notifications didn't give more details about the title. He didn't even notice it, though, as completely different emotions filled the dwarf.
Yes! Fuck yes, it worked! It worked! I'll live, you bitchy three-headed asshole!
Derek Smith felt the power coursing through his veins, through his legs. As gentle but hot energy flowed through his lower limbs, fatigue all but disappeared. He sprinted faster than ever before, as if he became Ariel Volt, the fastest human on Earth himself, and broke all known records.
Ah-ha-ha-ha! Kiss my ass, you stupid mutant!
Derek shouted as he disappeared from the monster's sight. After running for some time and passing a couple of fork paths, he could no longer hear his pursuer. Still, he didn't want to stop. The feeling of incredible power clouded his judgment.
This is amazing!
Derek enjoyed himself.
I feel that I can run like this for hours!
But his delight didn't last long.
Wait, what?
Suddenly, the world became pitch black.
The duration of dwarf senses has ended.
Thump. Then, with a heavy sound, Derek Smith collided with a hard wall at his full speed.
You have taken 11 physical damage. Warning, you have less than 10% of HP left. Your body is no longer protected by ether, so it'll take the full damage from all sources.
Grrr.
And then, to make matters worse, he heard two almost identical growls from completely different directions. No one said that there weren't even more monsters in the tunnels.
Shit, it hurts.
Derek tried to stand up as he leaned on the wall before him.
Dwarf senses activated. You have lost 5 MP. The calculated duration time is 25 minutes.
He used the talent to regain his sight. Then he touched the ground to detect the more precise location of the two monsters.
One is 30 meters away, and the other is 50,
the dwarf concluded. He had crashed into the wall with the right side of his upper body, so it seriously ached. Moreover, it seemed that the pain in his legs came back as well. Derek decided to check his current condition.
HP, 4 of 100. AP, 8 of 20. MP, 1 of 10.
Here we go again,
Derek sighed. As far as he remembered, he did have 4 HP just after the fall as well. Now, though, he also was low on AP and MP.
Considering how my plan with a bait didn't work that well, I shouldn't have disposed of the flashlight so soon. It still could have been useful to me, as I just can't sustain dwarf senses continuously. As things are now, it is only a matter of time until I'll be left in the complete absence of light without any way out. Then again, I doubt that the maglite is still working.
In any case, it was too late to regret. There is no way he could find the way back now, after sprinting for so long and choosing random branching paths again and again.
Wait a minute, Derek pondered. As I tried to sense those two freaks, there was something else out of the ordinary.
The dwarf used his vibration senses again to inspect his surroundings. Sure enough, he could feel it. About 100 meters away from his current position, there was a stream of water. The reason why he couldn't hear it with his ears was that a rather thin wall or rocks separated him from the stream. From what he could tell, the water current was rather strong, probably strong enough to flush away at least one of the monsters.
Okay, I guess it is worth a try,
the dwarf thought. Derek picked up Mjolnir from the ground and started to slowly walk towards his destination.
This new skill of mine sure burned through AP rather fast, Derek thought. I need to learn more about it.
Augmented sprint. Bronze. Common. Level 1, 28%. This skill is one of the basic ways to move your aura inside your body. With some effort, anyone can learn it. Guiding aura to your legs as a whole allows you to run faster than you normally could, without any fatigue whatsoever. Cool, right? Wide-eyed happiness. Effect. Increases your sprinting speed and gives you nearly unlimited stamina. The increase in speed scales with your speed stat and the skill level. Speed divided by 2 plus 10% times skill level. The current increase, approximately 3.8 kilometers per hour. Slow. Duration, 15 seconds at activation, then can be further sustained for additional AP cost. Cost. 20% of speed, rounded to AP minimum, at activation, then the same amount per minute. Cooldown. There is none.
A wry smile appeared on his mouth as Derek read the description. Subjectively, he felt that the skill increased his speed by way less than 4 kilometers per hour.
Then again, if compared to how sluggish I ran because of the exhaustion, maybe the skill indeed made me twice as fast. Compared to professional runners, though, I still would be a turtle even if I take this ability up to level 10, as long as my speed stat remains the same, whatever it is. On the bright side, I can sustain my maximum speed for way longer than any human, no matter how trained, could.
And here, his dream of being the fastest human, or rather the fastest dwarf on Earth, got crushed. Then again, as far as he knew, Derek was the only dwarf on the planet, so maybe he already won this title. Too bad the system didn't give it to him officially. It seemed to like giving people titles.
Shit, here they are.
As the dwarf was halfway towards the wall that separated him from the stream of water, two dark shadows appeared at the place of his crushing accident. One of them looked exactly the same as the monster that had chased him before, and the other was about 30% smaller, but otherwise not much different.
Are they a parent and a child?
Derek joked to himself.
Or maybe a husband and a wife?
In either case, the dwarf knew that he didn't have time to lose. He checked his current state.
HP, 5 of 100. AP, 10 of 20. MP, 1 of 10.
If I want to try and fight, I need to at least have 5 AP left to activate my stone body. Using augmented sprint for the starting 15 seconds would be more than enough to get me to my destination and would only cost 2 AP. Okay, go!
Instead of activating the skill automatically, Derek directed aura flowing through him towards his limbs and willed it to enhance his actions.
Augmented sprint is activated. You have lost 2 AP. The calculated duration time is 15 seconds unless the skill is further sustained.
Derek braced himself and, pushing his aching body, sprinted towards his greatest chance at survival in this damned place. Chapter 5. Water. Every living organism needs water to survive. There were some rare exceptions, but dwarfs like Derek Smith definitely weren't among them. He understood that if he wanted to leave this abandoned mine turned something else alive, he would need a stable source of water. And now he had found it. Derek couldn't know how long it'll take him to escape, but he, for sure, knew that it wouldn't be fast. It could possibly take days, and while he could literally eat stones, if the system is to be believed, he couldn't satisfy his thirst with them. So when he noticed the stream not far away from him, he decided to give his all to claim it for himself. At the same time, he had formed a certain plan that could help him get rid of the monsters that were attracted to him, just like bees to honey. The angry growls resounded from his back as Derek ran through the wide tunnel that led him to his destination. Thankfully, with augmented spirit supporting him, he didn't need to worry about being caught. When he started his sprint, less than 50 meters separated him from the wall that separated him from the hidden stream. It took him less than 10 seconds to get there, and his pursuers were still far enough for him to slow down without worrying. He could already vaguely hear the flowing water. After he turned off his running skill and almost stopped, the dwarf raised Mjolnir above his head. His muscles tensed, and he deeply inhaled.
Ah!
With a shout, Derek smashed the thin stone wall with his heavy hammer.
I hope it won't trigger any cave-ins,
Derek thought. With a loud bang, a hole about 1.5 meters in diameter opened, more than enough for him to sneak in. Just as he entered the small cave section with the water stream inside, the two creatures caught up to him. The one in the lead looked no different than that which chased him in the beginning. In fact, Derek could swear that it was the exact monster. The level 9 message floating above its head added to his conviction.
What the hell? How could it track me for so long and catch up so fast? Maybe they have a strong sense of smell? It will be problematic if this is the case. I also wouldn't be surprised if it used some sort of a shortcut to catch up to me so soon.
The second one looked alike, but 1/3 smaller. According to the symbols above its head, it was level 5. As the larger monster entered the cave section occupied by Derek, the smaller one just watched from the side as if giving up on the prey out of respect for its superior. Derek watched them anxiously as he walked backwards towards the water stream. This hidden cave chamber was only about 10 meters in length on all sides, 3 meters in height, and didn't have any other exits other than the one created by Derek. At the farthest side of the chamber, a 2-meter-wide turbulent stream flowed. From what he perceived with his dwarf senses before, this current of water seemed to be rather deep, and it moved further underground. As he saw that only one of the monsters decided to engage him, Derek slightly relaxed. It raised his chances, even if by a little. He watched his dreadful foe as he stood just a meter away from the roaring stream. His heart beat faster and faster from the anxiety and anticipation Derek felt as he realized that his whole life depended on the result of this battle.
Kee-ee!
As it saw its prey cornered, the creature emitted a disturbing noise that resembled laughing, with all three of its heads all at once. The sound almost made the poor dwarf stumble. For the first time, Derek could see this monstrosity in detail. With the lower body of a snake and its torso resembling a human, this would remind Derek of a legendary lamia, if not for the fact that it didn't look like any living thing should. As it only was about 3 meters away from him, Derek could distinguish that instead of skin or fur, black petroleum-like liquid covered its whole being. The smoke that emerged from inside of its grotesque body formed human-like faces contorted in agony. Each of its 3 bald heads revealed teeth full of shark-like fangs and a 1/2-meter-long crimson tongue. Overall, the creature reminded him of Venom from Marvel. Derek felt intimidated by the terrifying visage of his opponent, and his heart felt like it was trying to leap out of his chest. But he knew that to win he would need to consider his actions beforehand and never fight recklessly. After the creature's 9 glittering blue eyes stared at Derek for about 10 seconds, it decided to charge. It prepared to launch itself towards the dwarf in a strange, jumping, straightforward motion. In a second, it was over him, each of its heads ready to sink the shark teeth into his flesh. Fortunately, Derek Smith had prepared himself beforehand.
Stone body activated. You have lost 5 AP. You have lost 1 kilogram of stored minerals. The calculated duration time is 10 seconds.
In less than a second, the dwarf's whole body got covered in a dark brown solid shell. As Derek still wore his tracksuit custom designed by his mother and sister, only a small part of his skin was exposed, but even under his clothes, he changed completely. If he was naked, he would probably look like a human-sized, or rather dwarf-sized, clay figurine. The monster's central head bit into his left arm, the one he raised to protect himself and to execute his plan. Instead of pain, Derek felt a slight, tingling sensation. Before the 2-hand heads could join the feast, the dwarf used all his body's strength to change the positions with the monster. When it came to physical strength, thanks to him being a dwarf and the time he spent smithing, the power of his upper body was far beyond that of an average untrained human. Even without any prior weightlifting experience, he bench-pressed 110 kilograms 10 times when a friend challenged him 1/2 year ago. But even with this advantage, pushing the monster into the stream almost exhausted his already tired body.
I did it!
Derek thought in glee as the creature's lower body submerged under the water. But his delight didn't last even a moment as he noticed a powerful force pulling his left hand into the water. The monstrosity still didn't let go of his left forearm, and the dwarf even started to feel slight pain at the place where the shark fangs seized him tightly. Even if stone body made his skin as hard as the minerals he absorbed, the only ones he had found were of really low quality.
You have taken 1 physical damage.
The turbulent stream tried to pull both Derek and the creature together, but thankfully the former was a dwarf. He weighed almost 80 kilograms, which, considering his very low center of gravity, made him way more stable than a human who is even heavier but taller. In this situation, his short height became an advantage. Don't forget that he also still held the massive hammer in his other hand. All of this together allowed the dwarf to win a couple of seconds before he would be dragged along into the water flow.
Ah!
He inhaled and used his barely remaining strength to raise Mjolnir and hit the monster right in the center of its ugly main head. The creature let go of his hand, the stone skin of which already started to crumble.
Grrrr!
The monstrosity roared with three of its heads as it sank into the turbulent stream, which carried it away somewhere far away. There was one little problem, though. It didn't leave alone. Derek was still inside the cave chamber, but without his only weapon. Chapter 6. As the hammer struck the creature's head, it used its nimble and long tongue to grip the weapon tightly and then swallowed it whole. If Derek didn't let go of Mjolnir in time, he would follow the weapon and his adversary into the unknown depth.
You have dealt 7 physical damage. You have lost the connection with your weapon. Mjolnir is unequipped. Soulbound is triggered. Do you want to use it to find the location of Mjolnir?
Derek would be happy to read those notifications, but he didn't have the time. Since he activated Stone Body, only 7 seconds passed, and he had another opponent to deal with. Without wasting a second to contemplate over his unexpected loss, the dwarf charged at the second creature, which had already entered the cave chamber. Considering that it had already slithered halfway towards him, it probably wanted to help its larger companions as it realized that it was in a pinch. Derek knew that he was running out of time. His talent's duration was almost over. He wouldn't have much of a chance after losing its protection. Considering his exhausted body and low HP, he doubted that it would take much for the monster to finish him off. So he relied on a bold idea he had when he activated augmented sprint for the second time. Before, he didn't have the need, as his hammer was still with him. Now, though, it was worth a try. Derek felt the weak remains of aura that still flowed through him and used all his willpower to guide them towards his unarmed and rock-hard right hand. And then he punched, putting his whole being into the strike. Every last drop of his remaining stamina, every last drop of his remaining aura, every last drop of his will to survive.
Ah!
Derek roared.
I want to live!
He screamed in his mind.
You have dealt 101 physical damage. You have inflicted health suppression.
In the complete darkness, his fist shined with blinding white light as it penetrated the torso of the monstrous creature. Derek felt how burning pain traveled through his own body as if this attack burned his body from the inside.
You have taken 5 self-inflicted damage. Warning, you have no HP left. Your natural body recovery is temporarily not supported by ether. You have lost the effects of your defense and resilience. You have lost your HP regeneration for the next hour. Warning, you have no AP left. Your physical activity is temporarily not supported by ether. You have lost the effects of your attack and speed. You have lost your AP regeneration for the next half hour.
Even without reading the notifications, Derek knew that this punch left him completely drained in more than one sense. It also hurt like hell.
Congratulations, you have learned a skill. The Last Stand Attack, Silver, Ultra Rare. Congratulations, you have earned a title. Eh? I'm still alive? Common. Congratulations, you have earned a title. Self-harm enthusiast, uncommon. The duration of Stone Body has ended.
In the corner of his vision, one notification after another appeared, but none of them told of his foe's fall, because it didn't fall. Even the powerful punch that dealt more damage than Derek's total health didn't finish off the monster. Even if the hit sent it a few meters away and made a hole in its torso, it was still alive. The black liquid already started to close the wound. The health bar that floated above the creature decreased by barely more than a half. The level 5 monstrosity wailed. Whether in pain, in fear, or in anger, Derek didn't know. But what he knew is that his no longer fortified body didn't have any power left. The dwarf could barely stand without falling, but he still stared at the monster with his bloodshot eyes. One part of him hoped to scare it away, and the other part just was desperate. Fortunately, it seemed that this small creature wasn't very brave. Probably after witnessing how Derek disposed of its stronger ally, it already felt daunted. And after just one punch made it lose half of its whole health points, it completely lost the desire to confront the dwarf. After almost shyly hissing at Derek, the monster hastily slithered away. Even after it disappeared from his sight, the dwarf still tried to maintain his intimidating, aggressive pose.
I guess it proves that they aren't just mindless freaks of nature, but have a certain amount of intelligence. Damn, just perfect.
As Derek assumed that the creature was far enough, he relaxed a little. At least, he wanted to. But instead of just easing up his body, he just collapsed on the ground. And then, under the loud roaring of the turbulent stream nearby, he lost consciousness. Even with his dwarf senses still active, the world turned pitch black.
Ugh.
As Derek Smith woke up, he could sense the cold ground under him and hear the fast-flowing water nearby. He opened his eyes, but other than the heads-up display, only darkness greeted him.
Where am I?
Still confused, the dwarf tried to remember his situation.
Crap, how much time passed since I lost consciousness?
Derek wondered. The new notifications, which he could see in the corner of his sight, partially answered this question.
1 half hour has passed. You can now regenerate your AP again. 1 hour has passed. You can now regenerate your HP again.
So I lay here unconscious for at least an hour?
He thought, alarmed.
I'm really lucky to still be alive then, if I was found by any of those monsters in the meantime.
He shuddered just from thinking about it. Derek didn't try to stand up immediately. Rather, he first changed his position to lie on his back instead of his stomach. He felt that he still needed some rest. He took a rather comfortable position with his hands behind his head. Then he checked the bars on his lower left corner of sight.
HP, 9 of 100. AP, 20 of 20. MP, 5 of 10.
The information would tell the dwarf more if he could actually remember his regeneration rates. Back when he last checked his status, he didn't pay much attention because his alleged race freaked him out a little. Now, though, he assumed that he could afford to spend 5 more minutes and figure out more about the system. Considering that monsters didn't find him for more than an hour, he hoped that they wouldn't suddenly appear just after he woke up. In any case, to survive, he first needed to form a plan. And for that, he needed all the information he could get. He needed to figure out how this game-like system worked. As soon as he made his intentions clear in his mind, a long holographic screen appeared before him.
Status. Name, Derek Smith. Level, 1, 0%. Primary class, none. Subclasses, none. Race, Royal Dwarf, dormant, level 3, 47%. Professions, Mastersmith, rare, level 9, 56%. Student, common, level 4, 30%. HP, health points, 9 of 100. Regeneration rate, 20 per hour. AP, aura points, 20 of 20. Regeneration rate, 40 per hour. MP, mana points, 5 of 10. Regeneration rate, 3 per hour. Attributes, items and equipment, classes and abilities, race and talents, professions and masteries, titles and achievements, skills and spells, quests, trials and missions. Configuration.
What the hell is with this long menu?
Derek couldn't help but wonder. It would take way more than 5 minutes to figure everything out, and he didn't know how much he had before monsters would find him. At least the dwarf now knew for how long he had passed out. About an hour and a half.
Then again, now that I think about it, I could have just checked the cooldown time of my stone body.
Suddenly he felt that his tired and hurt body revitalized almost completely in just a moment.
You have regained 10% of your HP. Your body is supported by ether again.
Well, it's a piece of good news, I guess. Now I at least could run away from any unwanted encounters. But I need a more solid plan. I need time to fully recover and to understand all the menus from the status screen.
Still resting in complete darkness, with the stream nearby serving as a background music, Derek contemplated his future actions. Then, after a couple of minutes of brainstorming, he had a deceptively simple idea, and it seemed to be promising enough as well.
There is no harm in trying it out, the dwarf decided.
Chapter 7. After waiting until his MP recovered to 6 of 10, He didn't want another penalty. The dwarf activated his only ability that used mana.
Dwarf senses activated. You have lost 5 MP. The calculated duration time is 25 minutes.
The light returned to the world. Derek Smith could see his surroundings again. Not surprisingly, he was still in the partially hidden chamber with the water stream running on one of its sides. Using his muscular hands to support his rather heavy body, the dwarf stood up. Then he shook off the dirt from his clothes, his short hair, and his thick beard. The left sleeve of his jacket was completely ruined by a certain monstrosity not so long ago. Derek sighed with wistfulness as he remembered those two people who designed and made his clothes.
I hope that Mom and Sis are all right. Well, they both should be at home together with Dad, so they are safer than me, at least.
Thinking of his family also reminded Derek of his unreliable buddy.
I wonder what Andy is doing.
Initially, he planned to take his troublemaking friend with him on this trip. After all, the guy was the one responsible for losing Mjolnir. But alas, in the morning, Andy hadn't been at home and didn't answer the calls, which usually meant that he left on one of his hiking sessions, and he, most likely, did it on purpose because Derek warned him about their trip to the abandoned mine beforehand.
I hope that he'll survive, but only after struggling even more than me,
Derek smirked.
It would serve him right. All right, no time to waste on idle thoughts.
Just as the dwarf decided to execute his plan, he noticed that his throat was completely dry. This wasn't surprising, considering how much he had pushed himself today.
Okay then, I'll drink first.
Derek carefully approached the turbulent stream and then slowly placed his right hand into the cold water. He gathered some of it into his palm and then brought it to his mouth. Then he drank the fresh water with the joy of a traveler who spent days in the Sahara Desert before finding an oasis.
Oh, yeah,
he thought.
What bliss.
The water was cool and refreshing and, at the same time, slightly salty and carbonated.
So it is mineral water, then,
the dwarf concluded.
It could be unhealthy for a human to drink it too much, but I doubt that it is the case for stone-eating dwarves like me.
After feeling smug and scooping some more water into his mouth, Derek Smith decided that it is time to act on his plan. First, he approached the hole in the wall that he made and used for getting inside.
It is 1.5 meters in height and about the same in width. It would take some time, but it should work.
He moved towards the other side of the cave chamber. From what he could tell, it didn't have anything behind it. So no matter how much he would dig into it, it wouldn't lead to a cave-in. In fact, he could make a rather long tunnel out of it if he dug long enough. There was only one problem, though. He didn't have any tools on him.
Tools?
The dwarf smirked.
Who needs them anyway?
Then he guided aura to his now tightly clenched hands. Just like a gentle current of fiery liquid, this power that stemmed from his body traveled through his forearms toward his small but sturdy fists. The dwarf took a deep breath.
Ah!
With a loud exhale, he punched the stone wall before him. One right punch and one left punch. He felt the strong impact on his knuckles, but it barely hurt him. With two loud bangs, Derek created two openings in solid rock, scattering the debris around.
Congratulations, you have learned a skill. Aura Strike. Bronze. Common.
Derek expected to learn a new skill, but he didn't expect that there would be no notification about the damage dealt.
It makes sense, though, he realized. Objects don't have HP, after all.
He checked his aura bar.
AP, 18 of 20.
And then looked at the stones his hits had scattered around.
The plan seems feasible,
he concluded, and then started to move the rock debris to the chamber's entrance he made before. In the next 15 minutes, he repeated this process. Punch the wall, then take away the produced rock pieces. He rested a little in between those cycles to stay close to his peak form, just in case any monsters would happen upon him, or if the level 5 he scared away decided to return with backup, which was improbable but still possible. After all, those creatures seemed to be at least as smart as some more intelligent animals. They aren't just mindless mobs from video games that don't chase their prey and don't try to escape when odds aren't on their side.
I think it looks good enough,
Derek studied the completely blocked entrance to his cave chamber.
I hope those monsters won't sense me through the walls.
His plan was simple: to hide in this completely blocked room until his HP and MP were full. In this time frame, he intended to study his system and check the skills and titles he ignored so far. Before that, though, he had something else to do. As he already used more than 15 minutes of his dwarf senses, only 10 minutes of its duration remained. After that, considering his MP recovery speed, he would be blind for at least an hour.
I need to drink enough water and store some food,
Derek decided as he approached the side which he punched before for his barricade building materials. Some of the debris still remained. He started to gather all of them in one place. Then he used his aura strike a few times to decrease the size of some larger chunks of minerals. He needed them small enough to be eaten without any problems. Then Derek suddenly thought of his past experience with mineral consumption.
Ugh, I need to clean them before eating. Fortunately, I have a way to do just so.
So for the next 5 minutes, he took small rock chunks and washed them in the stream. He also didn't forget to take a couple of sips of water. He knew that trying to approach the stream in complete darkness would be foolish, to say the least. After a while, a small mountain of cleaned minerals proudly stood at one of the chamber's corners.
There are about 30 kilograms of them,
Derek roughly estimated using his experience as a smith. When it comes to smithing, you often need to determine the weight of items just from a glance.
Now I can, at last, rest for a while.
Derek took his place near the pile he created. He sat down on the cold ground as he leaned back to the stone wall. Strangely enough, it made him comfortable, more in touch with himself, so to say. The dwarf sighed deeply and then murmured to himself,
"Those were the hardest couple of hours in your life, Derek. You deserve some rest."
He smiled with content and closed his eyes. For a while, he just listened to the stream nearby and tried to perceive the newfound energies flowing through him. Health. Aura, mana. Based on what the system said when he completely used one of those resources, each was a form of ether. According to the strange existence named Enigma, ether is just another word for dark matter. As far as he learned from the internet and in school, this energy accounted for 85% of the whole matter in the universe, which is rather phenomenal if you asked him.
So I can probably use ether for smithing?
Just thinking about it made Derek Smith excited. He also didn't forget that the system officially recognized him as a Mastersmith. Didn't it mean that he could improve his craft even further? Even his foster father, Elliot Smith, recognized Derek as a genius smith. In just 7 short years, the boy had already surpassed his blacksmith teacher and even learned how to work with many different metals. And he had already earned some decent cash by selling his creations online. After the video of Derek titled, "The Real World Dwarf is a Cool Dude," which Andy posted, went viral, multiple talent hunters tried to recruit the young dwarf. Why would they? Obviously, they wanted him to be an actor in fantasy films and TV shows. But Derek still didn't show much interest in this career. For him, as long as he could enjoy his hobby and earn enough money to support himself, life was great. For some reason, his lack of desire to become a superstar always frustrated his little sister. As the dwarf stopped his idle thoughts, he opened his eyes, only to be greeted by complete darkness and one new notification.
The duration of dwarf senses has ended.
Okay, he decided. I guess this is the time for me to find out more about this system of mine, but there is something I need to check first.
Chapter 8. Derek Smith didn't forget how he had desperately fought for his life just less than 2 hours ago. And he didn't forget the cost of his survival, his favorite creation, his masterpiece. Fortunately, it seemed that he didn't lose it forever. He still had that chance to retrieve what belongs to him. Derek focused his attention on his notifications. Then he scrolled them to find the important message he had ignored at the time.
Trait Soulbound is triggered. Do you want to use it to find the location of Mjolnir?
Yes, of course I want to find it,
he screamed in his head.
Analyzing the location of Mjolnir, approximate position found. You can sense it now.
Derek expected to see some sort of a map, but instead, he just felt a tingling sensation in the back of his mind, and this sensation directed him in a certain direction. Below. Somehow he knew that his hammer was far away from him, deep below his current position and then also away by a couple of kilometers.
It wouldn't be simple to find it, the dwarf concluded. But I'll never give up. There is no way I'll return to the surface without taking Mjolnir with me.
Just as Derek felt his resolve solidify, a new notification appeared before him.
Your determination has triggered a new quest. Finding not Nemo, but Mjolnir. Easy, common. You lost something important to you. This is so sad. Very unhappy. Go and find your cute baby, Papa Marlin. Objective, find Mjolnir. Reward, isn't finding your treasure already the best reward possible? What, you want some compensation for your struggles? Okay, how does receiving a bonus of 70% XP sound? Yeah, I know, I'm just too generous. Joyful. Failure. You can't fail. This is not an option. Go find it. Twinkly wink. P.S. The quest will still expire after 72 hours.
Okay, Derek thought. It is something new. Why didn't my attempt to save my life by running away trigger any quests, though? I need to figure out how this works.
Even without the quest, he had already decided to take his hammer back, so this notification was just a pleasant surprise. Thankfully, it didn't add any ridiculous conditions like a time limit of 1 hour, with death being the result of the failure to complete the objective. Deciding that it was time for him to explore the options provided by the system, Derek opened his status screen. There, he looked at the menus available to him.
Attributes. Items and equipment. Classes and abilities. Race and talents. Professions and masteries. Titles and achievements. Skills and spells. Quests, trials, and missions. Configuration.
This list sure is long, but now I have enough time to check everything, at least if my hiding place is safe enough, which I believe is the case.
As Derek hoped that monsters wouldn't be able to find him behind all those walls, he opened the first menu.
Attributes. Ether attributes. ATK attack, 15. DEF defense, 15. MAG magic, 5. RES, resistance, 10. MND, mind, 8. SPD, speed, 7. FAP, free attribute points, 0.
It doesn't tell me much, he noted, other than the fact that the system thinks I'm more brawn than brain, and also kind of a slowpoke.
He tried to focus on the stats, hoping that it would give him more information, but nothing happened. Anyway, most of them were self-explanatory, but... F.A.P., really? The last line was probably for the stats he could distribute at level ups, but why the hell the system decided to name it FAP?
Let's see.
He decided to just continue browsing for now.
There seems to be more.
Basic attributes. STR, strength, 16. Upper body, plus. AGI, agility, 11. Manual dexterity, plus. CON, constitution, 27. Hardness, plus. VIT, vitality, 13, balanced. SPR, spirit, 8, earth plus, fire plus. CLR, clarity, 7, underground, plus. Extra attributes. INT, intelligence, 65, creativity, plus. WIS, wisdom, 69, smithing, plus. CHA, charm, 14, beard, plus.
What the hell does all of this mean?
Derek wondered.
Beard plus? Thanks for the compliment, Ms. System.
As with his ether stats, he couldn't get any additional information about his basic and extra attributes. From what he could guess, the additional words after the numbers were his specializations.
No matter how I look at it, he pondered, my mental stats are superior to physical ones, but I don't feel like a mage, not at all. Maybe intelligence and wisdom have nothing to do with magic? Then does it mean that the extra attributes are those that aren't combat-oriented?
As he wondered, the dwarf also didn't forget to check the remaining, rather short, part of the screen.
Hidden attributes. Aura control. 13.
Derek had a hunch as to when he learned his only hidden statistic, and he'll find out for sure soon enough.
Other than absurdly high intelligence and wisdom attributes, everything else is in line with my expectations.
The dwarf put a small stone into his mouth as he considered what he had learned so far.
Strength is my fourth highest attribute, and in reality I'm about 3 times stronger than an average untrained human of my age.
The dwarf swallowed a clean piece of rock and chose to digest it when asked by the system.
Does it mean that for most people, the starting points would be around 5? By these standards, I should be rather outstanding.
Immediately, though, he found a flaw in his logic.
No, it isn't necessary that the correlation between stats and capabilities is linear. It would also make more sense for the average to be around 10. Then it would mean that some of my attributes are below average, but others are incomparably strong. Like, for example, my constitution.
Derek put another little stone in his mouth and then cracked it with his teeth. Yeah, his constitution sure is high.
Strangely enough, but I can't see the actual math behind my attributes and HP, AP, and MP. Even though the correlation is obvious, numbers just don't add up that well. I guess I'll figure this out only after getting levels.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.